Welcome back to the Food Biotechnology Lecture. In the fifth part of this presentation, I will talk about lactic acid fermentation, but this time in vegetables, and I will show some processes for cabbage fermentation and for fermentation of olives. Lactic acid bacteria are normally present on plants. They live in the natural environment on the plants, and when we have very specific growth conditions, we can selectively get these microorganisms growing. So high salt concentrations, for example, they have this positive environment for the lactic acid bacteria, the pH, which is relevant for the growth, and of course the presence of oxygen. So with a series of specific parameters that we can set to these microorganisms, they have these very specific conditions that they can even be used for analytical purposes, analyzing, for example, vitamins or some amino acids in foods. So the main parameter that we have to set for lactic acid fermentations of foods when we ferment vegetables is the salt concentrations. At high salt concentrations, which is typically up to 8%, the growth of these lactic acid bacteria is favored, and the competing microorganisms, especially the pathogens and the spoilage microorganisms, have no chance to grow under these conditions. During the fermentation process, the salt extracts water from the plant material by osmosis. So when this water is extracted, the salt concentration is reduced even at the start of the process, and during the process it is further reduced. And if we want to maintain high salt concentrations, we have to add more and more salt during the process. Even if these lactic acid bacteria are a minority in the beginning of the process, due to these very selective parameters, to the selective growth conditions that we have, they very soon become dominant and can be more or less the only living microorganism which is present in the foods. In addition, when these bacteria produce lactic acid, we have the low pH, so high salt concentration, low pH, which is again in favor of this lactic acid bacteria, and it eliminates especially the pathogens. Again, here we see that the pH of 4.8, which is the limiting pH for pathogens, and if we get a pH which is below 4.8, we have a very safe product. One of the very typical products where vegetables are fermented is cabbage, and this fermented cabbage is called sauerkraut in Central Europe. And this is produced from the cabbage heads, where the outer leaves are removed, and the inner leaves, which have practically no color, so they are white, these are used for fermentation. So depending on the amount of leaves that are taken away from the outer part, the color becomes very white and very pale, and the product itself is also nicely white and pale. So if more of these outer leaves are removed, the product is colorless, more and more colorless. Again, we have to remove the hard stem from the core of the cabbage, because this cannot be eaten. The texture is not very nice. It's removed. And then this, the other leaves, they are finely sliced. These sliced leaves, very thin sections of the leaves, this is called slaw, and the slaw is mixed with salt. We have around 2.5 to 3% of sodium chloride, which is added, and then this mixture is packed very tightly into the fermentation vessel. And the fermentation vessel can be very small scale, so household scale, 1, 2, 3 kilograms, up to a few cubic meters. So there is practically no limit, no problem of scale up, is every scale is more or less the same process. During the fermentation, this osmosis extracts the water from the plants so that we have until some kind of end point where we have an equilibrium, an osmotic equilibrium between the plant tissues and the salt brine. So, in the start, the concentration of the lactic acid bacteria is low, but the selective conditions that we have, the high salt concentration, especially the high salt concentration, under these conditions, the lactic acid bacteria become quickly dominant, which is very important. And they more or less ferment the product. And after the fermentation, and this is the problem is that this is not really defined, so it needs a lot of experience of the person who is producing this fermented cabbage. So after the fermentation, the liquid is separated from the solid particles, the solid is packed and sold. So we have a very easily manufactured product in the end. And when we look at the time scale, the harvest of the cabbage is end of summer, beginning of autumn, and the product is fermented for a short period, and we get a very stable product, which can be consumed throughout the winter season. Nutritionally, it's very interesting because we have a very high content of dietary fiber, and additionally, to many other nutrients and vitamins, the vitamin C content is extremely high. And during the winter season, especially in the older times, where vitamin C was limited, the supply with vitamin C through consumption of fermented cabbage was very important to survive the winter. When we look at the microbiology of this fermented cabbage, we have some specific bacteria. It's the Leuconostoc mesenteroides and the Lactobacillus brevis. And they not only produce lactic acid, but they also produce acetic acid. And in parallel to acetic acid, they produce carbon dioxide. So both of these products are welcome. Limited amount of carbon dioxide is present. We have the acetic acid, low pH, the lactic acid with low pH. Other bacteria that are present can ferment the fructose into mannitol. And this mannitol is also important for the specific taste of the sauerkraut. And the Lactobacillus plantarum, as well as the Lactobacillus brevis, they both continue the fermentation until the end of the production, and they produce this round-up quality with a very nice taste, which is not too sour, and with little amount of sweetness in this composition. Good. Let's change the topic from vegetable fermentation to fermentation of olives. And olives are a little bit different. Olives have the problem that fresh olives contain oleuropein. Oleuropein is a very, very bitter tasting compound, so fresh olives can definitely not be consumed. And this oleuropein has to be removed first before they are used for fermentation or for consumption. So sodium hydroxide is used as a solution to extract the oleuropein and to destroy most of the oleuropein from the olives. Then this has to be removed again. It has to be washed away from the olives and salt is added. The concentration of salt is around 5 to 7.5%. Increasing the salt concentration during the fermentation process. So up to 9% of salt is present in the end product. There is a very mild lactic acid fermentation which takes place with low amounts of lactic acid produced, so 0.4, little bit more, percent of lactic acid is produced, and part of the oleuropein is still present in the fruits. So we have a mild acidity, we have a mild bitter taste, which all contributes to this nice aroma of the olives. This is a very characteristic mixture of this bitter and fruity taste. Looking at the microbiology, we have different bacteria and yeast present. So we have a combination of yeast and bacterial fermentation, which is typical for the olive fermentation. And the lactic acid bacteria include the Pediococcus, Leuconostoc, and Lactococcus. And the main bacteria that do the fermentation is, in the beginning, is Enterobacter aerogenes, which produces hydrogen and carbon dioxide. And at the later stage of the fermentation, Lactobacillus plantarum becomes dominant, and some yeast, Lactobacillus delbrueckii, so, but mainly Lactobacillus plantarum is present, and the pH is reduced to around 4.5. In combination again with this high salt concentration, we get a safe product. At the end of the fermentation, and this is quite interesting for the olives, at the end of the fermentation, we have only Lactobacillus plantarum present as a monoculture in the final product, and no other microorganisms are present. So thank you for your attention to this lecture, which was dealing with the lactic acid fermentation of plant products. Thank you.